So why should you care? So we noted down several examples. These are our examples, right? So it doesn't mean that these have to be your examples, but we challenge you, of course, to find your own reasons or your own description why you think blockchain technology is important for you, because that might differ for another person, right? So the reason we did this section is basically to give you a personal motivation, because there's a lot of content coming afterwards. But more importantly, we also want you to give the overview of this technology from a global scale, right? So you want to see what this technology might have for influence on the entire world instead of only your personal situation. So before we start, we will once more sum up the different properties of blockchain technology, public, decentralized, distributed ledgers, and then we will dive into different examples, right? So we noted down 10 different properties, and the reason is why there are 10, and they often take they're pretty similar, right? They all are tied with each other. Just remember that if you have a different blockchain, you most likely have a different trade-off in these properties. So once more, the answer of what are the properties of a blockchain depends, of course, on what kind of blockchain you're looking at. What is the moment in time? Because, for example, Bitcoin in 2010 is a different Bitcoin than the Bitcoin in 2019. So just keep remembering that as things change, these properties change with it, which is a good thing, of course, because different use cases will have a need of a different set of properties, right? So we noted down 10. There are most likely way more properties, but these are the most common known in the space. So the first one is immutability. We have an immutable ledger. You can't alter the ledger. It's an append only, as we often call, in case of the Bitcoin blockchain, of course. And Anders has shown this. If we change history, we will change the hash, and our hash of our node will be different than the hash of the other nodes. So in an instant, we can compare our history with the history of all the other nodes by hashing, of course, all the content. It is decentralized, which means there is no single party in control, which means we don't have the three risks of dishonesty, loss of records, and of course, exclusion. Third one is that it's open and public. Anybody can join the network. It doesn't matter who you are, etc., or where you're from. You can just download the node, become a node, or you can do peer-to-peer transactions. You can even become a miner. And of course, in the case of Bitcoin, it's quite difficult to become a miner. Well, becoming a miner is quite easy, but becoming a profitable miner is difficult as a solo artist, because there's a lot of competition to get to compete against. We will discuss this later on. It's transparent. Keep in mind that the only private thing in a public blockchain is your private key. All the other things, like your transactions, for example, are public, because it's a public ledger. There are no walls, right? You can see everything. What you can't see is the personal private key. And that's a good thing, because that's how you remain the boss of your data. It's censorship resistant, because each block has a certain amount of security surrounding it, cryptographically secured, as we've seen in the case of Bitcoin, for example, by the proof of work, as well as with Ethereum. It's very hard, and literally, technically, it's possible. Of course, there's a slim chance, and we'll discuss this later, to attack a blockchain. But bottom line here is you can't, as an angry government, for example, or an evil company, or an evil entity, whoever you are, it's really hard to alter the data. You can't alter the past. You need an immense amount of computational power. So basically, you have a censorship-resistant blockchain. You can't exclude anybody. You can't force things down on anybody, because everything is transparent, everything is public, etc. You see here, the censorship resistance co-works again with all the other properties. I didn't explain that as well as I wanted to, so we will dive into that section later on, because the time. It is secure. Of course, this depends on the blockchain as well. Remember the scaling trilemma, where security versus speed versus decentralization were competing with each other. You can't have all three of them. It's either secure, pick two out of the three. It's either secure, it's either fast, or it's either decentralized. In the best situation, you have two scenarios. Antonopoulos makes a good comparison. For example, if you compare this with being a consultant, you can either do something cheap, you can do it fast, or you can do it for a very high quality. Try to combine these three factors. Almost literally, not sustainably possible, of course. It's private, as mentioned before. You can make as many accounts as you want, as many private keys as you want, as you like, and therefore can interact in a pseudonymous way. It's neutral, the color of your skin is not important, your religion is not important, the region where you're active from is not important. In a public blockchain, you're nothing more than bits and bytes representing by a public key in this case. So it's a neutral technique, which is of course a very important property, in my humble opinion. Which we haven't fully discussed, but which we will discuss as well, is that it's smart programmable data. Not only don't we have thresholds anymore, but now you can actually make these data run a certain course in the ledger. In other words, it can automatically execute itself. So this, of course, increased the transaction cost efficiency enormously. So bottom line here is different blockchains, different trade-offs, different properties, different use cases. Remember that, right? There is no all overseeing blockchain that tackles it all. So in the case of Bitcoin, it's very good for sound money and security. And in the case of Ethereum, it's very good for new forms of governance and flexibility, right? Different blockchains, different properties, different use cases. Just like a shark and a lion are not competing. Just Bitcoin and Ethereum are not competing. Different use case. Keep that in mind. Next slide is also an important one. We've discussed this once more, so I will keep it short. To check whether, to answer the question, do I need a blockchain, yes or no, you need to answer yourself this. Can I trust the trusted third party in this case, yes or no? If no, then you need to go for decentralization. In other words, is the subject so important that you can never trust a trusted third party? For example, freedom of individuals, money, stuff like that. That are, of course, the use cases for a public blockchain. But to put bananas on a blockchain might not be all that interesting to put on a public blockchain, right? So if a trust in third party is bigger than the loss of the cost of inefficiency, then go for some more private version of a ledger. If that's out of the question, which it is, of course, with data ownership, self-sovereignty of money, etc., then most definitely go for a public blockchain. And keep in mind here that a centralized ledger is often more efficient than a decentralized ledger, which of course is inherent because a decentralized ledger needs time to reach the consensus, it's distributed, it's decentralized, etc. And a centralized ledger isn't, so it's faster. But on a global scale, of course, the open public blockchain is more efficient. And that's strange, right? Because on a local scale, the centralized one is more efficient, and on a global scale, the decentralized one is more efficient. So how does this work? Just see it as the banking example where all the different centralized bank ledgers are compared with one decentralized Bitcoin ledger, right? And in this case, the decentralized Bitcoin ledger is more efficient, it's cheaper on a global scale. In other words, it's easier to transact from country to country by using Bitcoin than by using the centralized ledger system. But if I want to make a transaction in my region from friend A to friend B, for example, or if I want to buy a cup of coffee, currently the centralized ledgers are more efficient, right? Because that's a local transaction, and on a local scale, the centralized ledgers are faster because then we're operating within the walls of that centralized ledger. But because all these centralized ledgers have walls, they often are combined with all them each other, combined all together, they're way less efficient than the public ledger without any walls. But of course, which is deliberately inefficient because we need time to reach consensus and we need people to prove that they actually worked on something in case of Ethereum and Bitcoin. So keep that in mind. If you are looking for a blockchain creation on your own, do I need a blockchain? If it's on a local scale, most likely go for a more private solution. If it's on a global scale, most likely go for the open public solution. And now we will go to the use cases where we think that centralized ledgers are out of the question. It's absolutely of the utmost importance that we actually nail this one with decentralized ledgers, because not only has history proven that the centralized ledgers don't work, but eventually it could turn up into a very nasty future if we don't. Curious? Just hop on to the very next example, and then we will dive into the reasons why we think open public blockchains are one of the most important innovative tools we currently have. See you there.